verse 2 of Romans chapter number 1, verse 1, which he promised before through the prophets in the Holy Scriptures. So we find that the gospel that Paul is saying I'm preaching is not only to the non-Jews, but the Jews are reminded to say this gospel is the same gospel that God prepared and began to share through the prophets, meaning the Jews understand to say the Torah that we have was given through the prophets. And is reminding them to say what Jesus came to do is to fulfill that which the prophets were sharing in the Holy Scriptures. So we find that the New Testament is the Old Testament conceived. Now the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed, because what the prophets said in the Old Testament has been fulfilled in the New Testament. So let's go back to the north. So we find that if Paul is preaching the gospel, which is the good news, then salvation is an ongoing process, not only for the Jews, but for the Gentiles as well. Verse 3 of Romans. Romans chapter number 1, verse 3. He says that the gospel I'm preaching is concerning his son. Which son? Jesus Christ, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh. So he's telling them to say, Jews, don't be offended with the gospel. Don't be offended with the gospel, because this gospel was the one that our prophets mentioned in the scriptures concerning Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Who is this Son of God? The seed of David according to the flesh. So he's telling them to say Jesus Christ is the Son of God who came through the family or the genealogy of David in the flesh. But spiritually, he is the Son of God. So to the Jews, they thought Jesus was a son of David. And when people looked at Jesus, they said Jesus is the Son of David. You remember the scripture as the apostle was sharing. That blind Bartimaeus, you remember what he called Jesus? Son of David! Son of David! Why was he calling Jesus Son of David? Because Jesus, according to Mary, the mother, and Joseph, they come from the family of David. So when Jesus was born, instead of people recognizing him as the Son of God, they were connecting to the flesh, to his heavenly parents, Joseph and Mary, to say, you are the Son of David. When he says, I'm Son of God, they were having trouble. You, we know your father is Joseph, and your mother is Mary. Why are you saying you are a Son of God? But they didn't know. But Paul is bringing now this, to say the Jesus that we are preaching is a Son of God. But in the flesh, he was born in the family of David. So he's trying to take them to say, we are not talking about two different people. Jesus is the Son of God who came in the flesh to be born through David, through Joseph and Mary, so that Jews can be taken back to say, in the same son of Adam, Abraham, and comes through to David, and it's the same Jesus who came. So he tells them to say, as believers in the church in Rome, don't just believe the Old Testament, the Torah. Believe the teachings of the New Testament. Why? Because the same Jesus is the one that has been declared from the foundation. And in verse 4 he says, who was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness, verse 4, Romans chapter number 1. Who was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. So we find that he is bringing Jesus as the Son of God. That's why anybody who says Jesus is not the Son of God is contradicting the scripture. But for you and me, who are believers, we know that the same Jesus who came to live on earth is the Son of God. People have got a problem to say, how can God be born in a human being? That's why the gospel is true. Because Jesus could not come as God from heaven and just come and drop on earth. From the scriptures of the Old Testament, Isaiah prophesied to say, one day, a virgin by the name of Mary shall conceive by the power of the Holy Spirit, and the Son shall be born by the Spirit of God. That's why you find that even people that do not believe in the scriptures, for example, the Muslims believe to say Jesus was born of a virgin. Okay, fine, if he was born of a virgin, then how does science tell us how a child can be born? You need a male and a female come together and then you have a child born. So meaning, if Mary, she was a virgin, there must be a power that came in contact with her in order for a child to be born. And that is the same thing that Paul is bringing to say, as Jews, don't just believe to say Jesus is a son of David, is God at the same time. And that's why we say, how was he born? Verse 4 declares, he was declared to be the Son of God. So Jesus Christ is the Son of God. How? With the power, according to the Spirit of God, or the Holy Spirit, by the resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ, our God. So let's get back to the notes. We find that it is in Romans that we discover that we have all sinned. Why is Paul emphasizing this in Romans chapter number 2 and chapter number 3? We may not have a commentary or comment on every verse because that might take us more time, but we can pick the key things that comes out of the book of Romans. So we have all sinned. Jews and non-Jews. We have all sinned. That's where we get that famous scripture that we have all sinned. Romans 3, I think 23 to 26. We have all sinned. Jews and non-Jews. You know, it is very important to grasp this point as Paul brings it, because to Jews, they thought by just obeying the law and the Ten Commandments, they were going to be saved. But Paul says, whether you are a Jew observing the law, you have sinned. And by the law, you'll be judged. As for a non-Jews, whether we don't observe the law and we say we believe God by faith, even by faith, you have sinned and you have to come to Jesus and repent of your sins. Jews who follow the law, they have also sinned. Meaning, the only way out is Jesus Christ. Those who have been observing the law as Jews, now come to God with your law, put your trust and faith in Jesus Christ. You who are non-Jews without the law, come to Jesus Christ, believe the gospel and acknowledge that you have sinned, and believe and put your trust in God. Amen. That's why we need Jesus. Jews need Jesus. Non-Jews or Gentiles need Jesus Christ, because he's the fulfillment of the law. How does the book of Romans divide? Let's go to our notes on page 2. So we find that point number 7. We've looked at the background. Now, how book of Romans. The book of Romans can be divided. Chapter number 1 to 8, 1 to 4 in that section is about faith. You remember, faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. Famous passage, and everybody says about that. Chapter number 5 deals with hope in God. There is no hope anywhere. The hope that we have is in Christ Jesus. Chapter number 5 defines sin, justification. We are justified just by putting our trust in God. Do you know that no matter what we did, the moment we came to Jesus Christ, we were justified. That's why when you go to court and then the judge says, we have gone through the case and all that you did, but this court says you are set free, you can go home. You don't need to bring all the evidence to say this. The judge says you can go home. When you go for a graduation, the one who is presiding over the ceremony doesn't need to get all your paperwork that you did from the first year to the last lesson you did. All he does is, today on you I'm confirming to say you have graduated, here is your certificate. You don't need the paper that he had to say, here you got 10%, here you got 20, no. All he does on that day of ceremony is, today I am giving you this certificate, you qualify. When we come to Jesus, no matter what we have done, as long as we confess our sins to say, Jesus is the Son of God, Jesus forgive me, on that day, at that moment, immediately, Jesus says, you are justified. That's why people cannot complain. Other faith, they want to go it by works. Because I have done this good deed, I have done this good deed, then I am accepted by God. But Paul writes to them, your faith, your trust in God, you are justified because you have accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. But so you find that from chapter number 1 to chapter number 8, it deals with all these issues. Chapter 6 to 7 deals with two particular problems of Jews and Gentiles toward the gospel. Jews wants to come to Jesus Christ to say, because we obey the law, we are the righteousness of God. But Paul says, no, you must put your faith and trust in God. We have all sinned. Gentiles, you are coming to God. You are also prone to license. You know, there are times that Christians, as believers, we think we are more righteous than others. Sometimes it's because of the good deeds. And it's very easy to get into the trap of thinking that because we are non-Jews, we don't need the law. Jews also are prone to legalism. Just like people say, we observe the law, I observe the Sabbath, I don't drink on the Sabbath, I don't sin on the Sabbath, I don't do this on a particular day, and they go into observing all these things. There are people that think they are more closer to God because they observe certain things, but God says no. You are not closer to God because you observe the rules. We come to God because we put our faith and trust in God. So both groups, the Jews and the Gentiles, needed a focal point, who is Jesus Christ. If we go by just the law to say we observe the Ten Commandments, even today, in some churches, they've got a list of rules. Don't do this, don't do this, don't do that, don't do this. There are people who say they observe the Sabbath, They can't drink, they can't do evil things on a Sabbath, but go and do on a Tuesday. What's the difference? God does not live on a day to say this day is holy. All days are holy before God. 7b, we can divide the book of Romans from chapter number 9 to 11. Book 4 is dealing with the dispensation and hope. It deals with the place of Jews in the gospel and church and the church. I don't know if you've ever heard of replacement theology, where people think God now doesn't need the Jews because Christians now are the ones that have taken the place of Jews. That's a lie, because God gave the word to the Jews, and we have come to believe the word of God. Jews and non-Jews, we are all one. We all need God. So the theology that we have taken over the Jews is not true. The Jews are still there on earth. They are still God's people. We have come as non-Jews to believe in the God of the Jews. We all need God. So chapter number 9 to 11 deals with that issue of Jews and non-Jews coming together by faith. Chapter number 12 to 16 is the practical. How do we live? We live by love. The theme of Jews and Gentiles, non-Jews, tension continues. It offers practical issue of conduct, not to focus on the day's worship, for example, the Sabbath, what type of food to eat, non or non-kosher food, food offered to idols. We all need flexibility. That's why there are people that they are so much into legalism. No, we can't do this because it's a day to worship God. But the law of faith demands that